Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Vatta's War by Elizabeth Moon. Book 2. Marque and Reprisal, Part 2. Narrated by Nanette Savard. With performances by Christopher Scheeren, Colleen Delany, Andy Clemence, Stephen Carpenter, Barbara Pinolini, Tim Carlin, Christopher Graybill, Joe Brack, James Lewis, Danny Gavigan, Ken Jackson, Michael Glenn, Terence Aselford, David Coyne, Casie Platt, Dylan Lynch, Yasmin Tuazon, and Richard Rohan.
Kailara Vatta stared at the three apparent tourists who had tripped the perimeter alarms that had been set up around the dockside access by her security chief, Gordon Martin. No longer would Kai hire outside security personnel, even from the most reputable company, here at Lastway or anywhere. The last one she'd used had tried to kill her. The crew of the Gary Tobai now wore basic torso protection if they were outside the ship for any reason. Kai didn't want anyone catching any stray projectiles meant for her. Now, three strangers, a man, a woman, and a skinny teenaged boy, stood in a silent row, with Martin and Bea Chalk looming over them. The attractive but faded blonde in the taupe suit smiled at her.
Hello, Kai. I'm your cousin Stella. Remember me?
Stella? Here?
Kai struggled to remember how old Stella's child might be. Stella did look older and plainer than she remembered. That Stella had a man, she could believe. He was medium tall, handsome as a vid star in spite of his graying hair, and very aware of it.
What are you doing here?
Running away. Or running to you, depending on how you look at it. How much do you know?
Vada's been attacked. I don't know how bad it is.
Not a very big ship, is it?
Big enough.
Have there been any attacks on you?
A few. Unsuccessful, obviously.
Oh, my heavens. She's a total innocent. What are you thinking, Stella? She can't possibly...
I don't know what you think is innocent. I've killed...
Kai was appalled that she had to stop and count.
Four men!
We heard about one at Sabine. You did it yourself? Really?
Yes. And it was two there.
My, aren't we the rough girl?
The man turned again to Stella.
So she can kill. But can she...
Stop it.
To Kai's surprise, the man stopped, arching a brow at Stella, who turned to Kai.
Kai, this is Rafe. We're partners for the present. He's under partner bond. He has many... talents.
That's nice.
And this is Toby Vatta. He survived the blowout on Alray, too. Have you heard about that? And he's also a partner for the present.
Kai looked at Toby and had an immediate flashback to her own apprentice voyage. She'd thought having Captain Furman on her tail was bad, but she hadn't been through what he had.
Welcome aboard, Toby. I'm sorry for your loss. I assume Rafe has a last name, Stella?
Yes, which we will give you when we come aboard, not standing here on a cold dockside. Kai, we had trouble on Alray. Serious trouble.
I can imagine. We've had some, too. Come on aboard, then.
Kai stepped aside and let them pass. Stella gave her a look she could not interpret, and Rafe, a look she could interpret all too well. If he thought she was like Stella, he would soon learn different, and he could keep those eyes to himself. She nodded at Martin when they had cleared the locks.
Come on, Martin. If anyone comes looking for cargo, let Aline handle it. It's close of trade anyway.
Yes, Captain.
The others had stopped in the wreck area. Kai nodded to a table.
Have a seat. Let's find out what's up.
It's a long story.
It's a long shift. Go ahead.
You know about the attacks back home on Slaughter Key?
Some, not much. They hit corporate headquarters and the family compound both, one report said. I expect there were injuries. And for some reason, the government is down on us.
Kai, I'm sorry. I have bad news for you. Your parents... Your mother died in the attack on the house. Your father died of injuries received trying to save her and others.
Kai felt her face stiffen. Now that tiny sliver of light, that window of hope, slammed shut. She had been so sure, she had hoped so much, that they had not died, or at least one of them survived. She thought she'd anticipated this, but it was too much.
And your brother San. I'm sorry, Kai. My father was killed, too, in the bombing of corporate headquarters. My sister Jo died in a separate attack.
Kai felt each name as a separate weight falling on her, pushing her deeper into darkness. Her father, her mother, her brother, her uncle.
Aunt Helen?
Mother was alive when I left Slaughter Key. So was Aunt Gracie Lane.
Gracie Lane and her fruitcakes with diamonds were a poor substitute for the rest of the family. The memory of her father's face in that last call, the look in his eyes, came to her vividly. She squeezed her eyes shut, trying not to think, not to see.
Aunt Gracie sent me to find you.
Surprise almost melted the numbness. Kai opened her eyes.
To find me? She thinks I'm an idiot.
She thinks everyone our age is an idiot. But she thinks you're the one person who can sort this out, and she thinks I'm capable of helping you. She knew you needed more data and some help.
Aunt Gracie is...
pretty smart, actually. Did you know she'd been in the war?
Aunt Gracie?
Yes. I didn't know either until she told me. And showed me. At any rate, she told me to come find you and bring you the Vatta command database to download into your implant.
Kai's hand went to her head.
I don't have an implant. It was destroyed.
But I know your father sent you another one.
I haven't put it in. I'm not supposed to put one in for 6 months.
Counting up the weeks in transit to Belinta, from Belinta to here, it was a lot closer to 6 months than Kai had thought.
Brain damage?
Possible neural instability. And how did you get hold of the command database? I mean, if my... your... our fathers were killed in the attacks...
Stella looked away.
Well, your father lived a few days, Kai. And Aunt Gracie took charge of the implant.
Kai stared at her. Her stomach roiled. She did not want to consider what that meant, or how it had been done.
At any rate, if you're going to take over as the off-planet Vatta representative, you'd better find a way to use the implant information.
Well, you could.
No. You have military training, Kai. I don't. My expertise is all in another direction.
And that is?
If you access the database, you'll know. I'm not sure I should tell you here.
Stella glanced aside at Rafe and Toby. Kai felt a cold prickle run up her spine.
As if you hadn't learned half or more of it from me. But I suppose we must protect innocent young ears.
Toby turned to glare at him. Kai felt the same way, but didn't let herself show it.
Later, then. If I'm the designated whatever, though, I'll need to know.
Understood.
The others could be another distraction. Kai turned to the boy.
Toby, how far along in your apprenticeship were you? What kind of ship duties did you learn?
The boy flushed, but met her eyes.
I was over half through, and had completed the training modules and all the specialties, so I was working full shifts under supervision. I'd done environmental and engineering, and was working on navigation and piloting. In port, of course, we all worked cargo.
Excellent. I know you don't have any of your scores, and unfortunately I need documentation of your training, but we have new crew who are working on their certification exams. Lastway has a complete roster of spacer certification courses, and the sooner you begin, the better. What's your strongest field?
Probably drives, ma'am. I did well in all the engineering subspecialties, but peers... Chief Barklin said I had a good feel for space drives.
Good. I could definitely use a good backup drive specialist. I'm going to assign you to that area. You'll be informally assessed and then start formal classes in a couple of days. That suit?
Yes, ma'am.
I don't know when we can get you back to a place where you can have regular formal schooling. What were you planning on, or had you decided?
I was supposed to go to Turqua, the main engineering prep school on my home planet, ma'am. And then I hoped to get to Divisi Tech for advanced work, and then back to the fleet.
Huh. Well, I'll download additional coursework for you for when we're en route. No sense in having you lose more educational time than necessary.
Kai turned to Rafe, who was watching this with a condescending expression.
Now, you, sir. Your last name, if I may be so bold.
He leaned forward, meeting her eye, and putting on what Kai assessed as a pseudo-honest expression.
Of course, Captain. Though you may as well know that I have several last names, by which I'm known on different worlds. I was born with Dunbarger, but haven't used it for years. Stella first met me as Raphael Stoner Modestin.
Dunbarger?
I said I haven't used it for a long time. It's not euphonious. It is, however, my birth name if anyone were to track it down.
Dunbarger?
Yes, that Dunbarger. The one you're so obviously trying to remember. ISC senior officer, very senior at the moment.
Into Kai's mind popped the memory of ISC's command structure. Dunbarger stood right at the top.
You might consider me a remittance man, if you know what that is.
You're Garston Dunbarger's son? You?
I had to learn company manners somewhere, the knowledge of which fork to use and how to tie a cravat is easiest learned in the kind of home my parents kept.
Very interesting, if true.
Oh, it's true. I can even prove it, though I prefer not to call down the kind of trouble that would bring on last way. At any rate, I was sent away. For cause, I might add, no bad feelings on my side, and strongly encouraged to choose another name, or 50. And later, here's another new tidbit for you, Stella. Later, I was hired back, as it were, after a bit of good behavior, which somewhat softened my father's attitude.
Hired back how?
Rafe's gaze dropped to his fingernails, which he appeared to study with great interest.
There are things that a supposedly disaffected, disinherited former member of a powerful family can find out, can elicit, that almost no one else can. If you know where both ends of the string are, as it were, untangling the mess someone's made of it is far easier. By birth, I know one end. By experience, I discover the other.
You're a company spy.
That's a bald word for a very fluffy concept. Let's just say that I've been put in the way of finding out things ISC needs to know and have been well paid to transfer that knowledge to ISC. I'm still not welcome at home, but relations are, as it were, softening with time. None of my sisters has produced an heir, and father would like a grandchild. Well, actually, it's mother who wants one worst, I suspect, but father's putty in her hands.
You contemptible toad!
Now, Stella, sweetling, no need to blow a jack.
Don't sweetling me, you... Kai, this miserable excuse spent two whole days lecturing me on the evils of my past, my luxurious and pampered past, convincing me that I was to blame for the inequalities of the universe because I'd never questioned where Vatta money came from, and all that time...
How do you suppose I knew what leverage would work, my dear? It takes one to know one. I knew what would sting me, and thus that it would sting you. And besides, you're so sweet when you feel guilty, as opposed to the way you are when you don't. And don't say you'll hate me forever because you know you won't.
Toby, Kai noticed, was watching this with wide eyes.
I still don't have a last name. Not the one on your current ID, at least.
Oh, yes.
For an instant, a patch of color appeared on his cheeks. He fished out the ID packet and handed it over.
It's fake, of course, and only of moderate quality. I had it done in a rush before we left, to throw off pursuit, we hoped. Stella's is fake, too, at the moment. It seems to have worked.
Ralph San Volen.
I was using Murchison back on Allray and running a shop selling antiquities and books.
And other things.
And other things as necessary to keep my lines of contact open with the kinds of people ordinary ISC personnel cannot know.
Rafe glanced at Stella and then back to Kai.
You must realize that those people do not trust straight arrows.
I know that.
Good. Because if I'm to be any use to you, I need to establish my lines of communication here.
Kai ignored the presumption in that for the moment. She wasn't sure she wanted him to try to be of use to her.
You've been here before?
Oh, yes. Some years back.
Just as a matter of curiosity, when does your partnership contract with Stella and Toby expire?
Not too long now, I think.
I suspect you know to the minute, Rafe. Let's not play games.
But games are such fun. All right. In about 23 hours. Why? You gonna ask me to extend?
I'm thinking about it. It seems to me that Vatta and ISC interests run together lately.
They may at that. But my interests intersect ISC's only in particular areas. Perhaps we should both think about it.
And discuss it in, say, 4 hours?
As the captain wishes.
Whoever he really was, someone had taught him manners, and more than one kind. Kai looked again at his gray hair.
How old are you, really?
You want all my realities revealed? Very well.
He scrubbed at his face with his hands. When he brought them down, a much younger man grinned at her, his face subtly reshaped, his eyes sparkling with mischief.
The hair's not this gray or this thin, either. But I'd prefer to deal with that in a proper bathroom. If this ship has a proper bathroom. I'm only a year older than Stella in true biological time, but I'm much, much older in experience.
Kai caught a movement of Stella's hands and glanced over to find the perfect cheekbones restored to the breathtaking beauty she remembered. Stella opened her hand.
Cheek pads. And my hair's not really this color. Rafe's got black hair, if you want to know.
Kai looked at Toby.
Rafe wouldn't let me. He says as fast as I'm growing, I'm not the same 2 days in a row anyway.
That's a relief. Wait here while I get Toby settled and see about finding you berths. I presume you'd rather stay aboard than on station?
I would.
Even though Avada's ship was blown up in dock at Allray?
Even though.
I will do as the captain prefers.
Rafe tilted his head at Kai, leaving, for now, hanging between them, unsaid.
Fine then. I'll be back shortly. Come on, Toby.
Toby followed her out of the wreck area. Martin trailed along.
I need to get back dockside, Captain, if that's all right.
That's fine, Martin. Go ahead.
Martin nodded and turned away. Kai walked on, wondering what she could say to comfort a boy who had lost his family and shipmates. Damned little comfort in the universe, but that wasn't what he needed to hear. On the other hand, maybe he didn't need comfort as much as something to do.
Stella says you're also in this partnership.
Yes, ma'am. Captain.
What do you think of Rafe?
Me? I'm just
old enough to be a partner, Toby. That's old enough to assess the character of a partner by law. What do you think of him?
I don't exactly know. He knows a lot of things I think are probably bad things, but he's been a good partner so far.
Does Stella trust him?
In partnership, yes, but not before. She had me hold a weapon on him before we formed the partnership, when she was showing him what she carried.
Kai turned and looked at him.
Trusts you, doesn't she? Could you have shot him?
I think so.
He looked tense and worried, which was, Kai thought, exactly how he should look when he contemplated the possibility of killing someone.
Good. We'll try to keep you out of such situations in the future, but just in case, I'm glad to know you're that reliable.
She led him on into engineering, where Quincy was leaning over Jim at one of the workspaces. Puddles, the puppy Jim had rescued from a trash bin in the station, lay at his feet, chewing vigorously on his leash. Quincy looked up.
Who's this, then?
Toby Vatta, survivor of the attack on Ellis Fabry at Allray. News was wrong. They weren't all killed.
How'd he...
My cousin Stella brought him.
Kai cut off further questions with a warning glance.
Toby, this is Quincy Robin, one of the most senior engineers in Vatta, and from this point on, your tutor. Quince, Toby was more than halfway through his apprentice voyage, and he says his instructors thought he had an aptitude for drives. Since I have no idea when we can get him home, we need to set up a complete educational course for him, find him bunk space, and get him fitted out with whatever he needs. Can you see to that? Order in whatever you need. I have some other urgent business.
Of course. Toby, is it? You're in a growing stage, aren't you? I recognize the signs.
Is that a dog?
It's a nuisance. Jim's idea.
It's a puppy. Do you know anything about dogs?
I had a dog back home, before I left for ship duty. She was a maze hound. She didn't look anything like that, even when she was born.
Kai had no idea what a maze hound was, but for the first time thought there might be a purpose in having a puppy aboard.
This one's supposed to be a Jack Russell Terrier, whatever that is. His name's Puddles.
We'll need to stock extra rations, Captain. Boys this age eat like a regiment.
Quincy seemed to glow with a sudden burst of grandmotherliness, which was just what the boy needed, Kai felt sure.
I'll put it on the list. Jim, come along with me.
Jim's face took on a worried expression, but he got up quickly and followed her back to the rec room.
Toby's getting settled. This is Jim, one of my crew, late of Belinta.
Belinta?
What's wrong with Belinta?
You wanted to leave. Don't tease him, Rafe.
Happens to everyone, one time or another. And you got out of Belinta. So what else are you bringing to the party?
It's not a party. I need to talk to my cousin alone, and I don't want you wandering the ship by yourself. Jim, you'll stay with Rafe until I come back. And I mean stay with, not just in the same half of the ship.
Jim looked at Rafe with sudden suspicion.
Oh.
I am so misunderstood.
Kai tried not to grin. It would not do to let this rascal know he was amusing her.
The misunderstanding, if any, is mutual.
Is it? Perhaps it is, Captain Vatta. I will be good.
Excellent. Jim will show you around. If you decide to ship out with us, you'll know what you're getting into. Now, you'll excuse us. Stella, come with me, please.
With a final nod, Kai left them, and Stella trailed after her. In her own cabin, she gestured at Stella to the bunk and sat at the desk herself.
You've changed.
The last time we met, I was, what, 17?
There's that. But I was worried for you when I heard about that mess at the academy. You had always been such a straight arrow.
I've wanted to thank you for your note. It did help, especially since I'd just had a stinker of a letter from Hal, from a man I'd known there.
Men. And while we're on that subject, a word of warning about Rafe.
You think I need one?
Every woman needs one with him. I'm sure you feel the magnetism. I certainly do. But he's not a safe ride.
I could tell. But let's get to business, Stella. You say Auntie Grace sent you...
Stella sat up straighter.
Yes. Your father tried to call a meeting of the adult Vattas on Slaughter Key after he was hurt, but he collapsed and Auntie Grace took over. It surprised everyone when she picked me to be her messenger. She knew... Well, she'd kind of pushed me into it, that I acted sometimes as a special courier for Vatta. You didn't know that, I think.
No, I thought...
You thought I was flighty Stella, still in disgrace. So did a lot of people, which made my other role more effective. When I traveled, people assumed it was just that idiot Stella wandering around being a tourist.
Stella cocked her head to one side, and her expression shifted. She looked the picture of an inexperienced pretty girl. Stella lost the innocent waif look, and Kai admired the technique. She didn't seem to move, and yet she changed.
My father knew, of course. Your father didn't. That made it awkward sometimes.
I can imagine.
Her own father bragging about his practical, sensible, obedient daughter, while her uncle had to pretend that Stella was still a bubblehead.
Anyway, Auntie Grace downloaded the Vatta command data set to her own implant. She doesn't think any of the surviving Vatas off-planet have it, and she wanted you to have it because of your military training. Kai... How bad was your head injury? If you're going to be in command out here, we need to know if you're capable.
I'm capable. Stella, the things that I've done after that indicate that I'm functioning just fine. It was bad. They had to do a memory dump off my implant.
A memory dump? Who did that?
Mackenzie, a mercenary company. Quite respectable. They're in the Green Book. Vatta's transported them or their cargo more than once. It was an accident, really.
Quickly, Kai gave Stella the bare-bones account of the incident.
And then I woke up in their sick bay, and all the interesting stuff happened later. So if I could cope with mutinous prisoners and an uncontrollable ship and near starvation, I think that means my brain is working, right?
Right. I don't quite understand why you can't install another implant, though.
Their surgeon said I should wait 6 months to be sure the memory dump and the structural repairs were consolidated and stable. I don't know the details, but I'd had those years of training without an implant at the academy, aimed at preparing for just such an emergency. It doesn't bother me to be without one.
I don't know if the Vatta situation can wait another, what is it, 3 months more?
Well, less than that by now, I think. But I don't see why that matters. Unless the command data set explains who our enemy is and what's going on. And if it does, our fathers would have been prepared. I don't need an implant to fight a war.
A war. That's what Aunt Gracie said. It's war now, she said, and we need someone with military training to take over. Meaning you. I still think you need an implant. Wait a minute. You already thought of it as a war? And yourself is fighting it? Without any resources but what you have here?
Not many options, are there? What was I going to do, run away and hide somewhere? I was sure other Vattas had survived somewhere. We'd need to get together somehow.
I suppose. I just didn't expect you to have worked all that out. Well then, General, or Admiral, or whatever you are, what do we do now?
Kai was ready for this one.
I find out what you've brought besides the data set, and I see if the data set can be accessed without an implant. I doubt it has anything really useful to me at this point, but it might. I find out what Rafe's up to, because I'm sure it's more than he said, and decide whether to take him with us, let him go, or kill him.
You'd kill Rafe?
Kai enjoyed the shock on Stella's face.
If I judged him a danger to the family, of course. It is a war, Stella. We're already in trouble, already losing, if you look at the numbers. We can't afford to let anyone, however charming, cause us more damage.
Now that's sensible.
Rafe was at the cabin door, with Jim behind him, looking worried.
Captain, you were right. I did underestimate you.
And I clearly underestimated you, thinking that Jim could keep you away from my cabin.
Kai kicked herself mentally for not having closed and locked it. Rafe gave them both a smile of blinding goodwill.
We were on our way to the bridge. I merely overheard one sentence of extremely good sense, nothing more, I assure you. Stella, you are a genius in your own way, but your cousin Kai has won my fickle heart.
The reverse, however, is not true.
Of course, I would not expect it. I look forward, Captain, to our discussion of partnerships when the time comes.
Rafe turned to Jim.
The bridge, perhaps? And perhaps we should close the hatch to allow the captain more privacy?
Thank you.
On the bridge, he would find Lee less malleable than Jim. When they were alone again, Kai turned back to Stella.
So tell me about Rafe, everything you know.
Everything I thought I knew. I certainly did not know he was Dunbarger's son. If he is, though that explains a lot. It was after that disastrous mess with Jamar, the one I gave the codes to. I'd been stuck at home for months, of course, lectured at by everyone over the age of 10. Stupid Stella, idiot Stella, how could you, Stella? Didn't we tell you, Stella? And so on and so on. Of course, I was telling myself the same thing. Then Aunt Gracie showed up, shooed everyone away, told me to quit moping and get a hold on myself, and sent me to an old friend of hers over on Casagar. Find out what you're good at, Gracie said, because you are a Vatta. And therefore, you have talents besides looking pretty and attracting bad men.
Sounds like Aunt Gracie.
Yeah, well, her old friend Halma turned out to be a fellow veteran. That's when I found out about Aunt Gracie's own checkered past. I got a fast course in courier protocols, and she sent me off to another friend halfway around the planet. Apparently I did all right, because that one sent me back with a good report. I thought it was all great fun. You had to follow the rules to the letter, of course, but it was the kind of challenge I like, blending in and being someone else, or at least being the foolish, stupid Stella on the outside while being a competent Stella on the inside, if you can follow that.
Yes, I can.
Well, I was on another job for Aunt Gracie's old friend at an embassy party on Casagar when I met Rafe. He recognized that I was trolling for information just as I recognized he was the same, and he called me on it. I didn't know what to do. It was my first political assignment. So I fell back on girlish giggles and sex appeal, and he wasn't having it. I'm still not sure exactly how it happened, but the next thing I knew, he was teaching me to use his pick locks, which is a very useful skill, and I still use the set he gave me. And not too long after that, I realized he was the sexiest man I'd ever met. Jamar wasn't within 6 orders of magnitude.
Stella grinned and shook her head. Kai thought of Hal, but shied away from that memory.
Also the most dangerous. Also someone with contacts I'd never even imagined existed. He seemed to have a finger in every clandestine organization on Casagar.
His story then was that he'd worked his way up from a state orphanage to a private investigator's license, learning formal etiquette from training tapes. But we both understood that considerable dubious actions were involved. We worked together briefly, then I went back home to Slaughter Key to be debriefed by Aunt Gracie, after which she and my father employed my skills at intervals.
I see. So, do you consider Rafe trustworthy?
Before the latest revelations, I would have said that Rafe stays bought if you pay his asking price and that he's reliable in partnership agreements. After all, I turned my back on him this time. But I'm not sure now. If he's really Dunbarger's son and really a permanent ISC agent, then he'll be with us, or anyone he contracts with, only so long as it doesn't cross ISC.
I'm not planning to cross ISC. And they should be pleased with me after the Sabine thing. So with those circumstances, what about partnering or hiring Rafe? And which would be better?
Partnering. And yes, I think he'd be a good asset, though I'm still peeved that he never told me. But what use am I, Kai? What can you do with me?
I don't know yet. We may have use for an agent of our own when we come to some place where you aren't known and won't be an instant assassin magnet. Meantime, you were home more than I was the last few years. You may know a lot about recent developments in the company that I didn't know.
And I can scramble eggs. I'm not trained for ship's crew, but some of my skills will transfer.
Well, that's good. Besides, your family. And there's little enough left.
That black weight bore down on her shoulders again. Kai struggled not to break down.
True. There's not been time to grieve, really. It all happened so fast. Though at least I had the time on the courier to myself, it must be worse for you, being out of touch when it happened.
I don't know. It still seems unreal. They've always been there. Parents, aunts, uncles, corporate headquarters, the house. I can almost pretend they're still there, but you can't.
Reality bites. Well, you've got Toby settled. That's a good thing.
Unless someone blows this ship. I do think about that. We should find him a safer place. He's our future. Stella, does Aunt Grace have any idea why the government turned on us?
She wasn't sure if someone had outbid us or scared them silly. When I left, she was planning to find out and see if she could correct their thinking, as she put it. I would not like to be the president with Aunt Grace after him.
Stella drew her finger across her throat. Kai debated for a moment and took the plunge.
Stella, there's a very odd thing. Before this happened, someone had sent me a message here to be held for my arrival. I have a letter of marque from Slaughter Key.
But nobody does that anymore.
That's what I thought. But they do, and I have one. Here.
Kai handed Stella the padded folder.
This is incredible. When did you get it? You're sure it's official?
It came via someone I knew at the academy. I'm sure of the provenance, but I'm not sure it's still valid.
Kai took the folder when Stella had finished reading and put it away.
Still, it gives me justifications other than family to go after whoever's doing this.
I never knew Slaughter Key ran privateers. I thought I knew a lot about local politics. How did they keep this secret, I wonder?
I heard rumors. I just thought it was vicious slander, but clearly it wasn't.
Privateer. Valid or not, with the Slaughter Key ansibles down, who's to know?
Not Rafe. I'm not ready to tell him all my secrets. Besides, can you really see this ship attacking and capturing anything? Thing is, even if I were a military genius, I can't see how to fight a war with one old tub like this one. She's slow, she's vulnerable, and she has no teeth.
Would money help? I've got some in the usual hard goods from Aunt Gracie, and my own resources.
Money always helps. Enough to buy a real warship would certainly help, but I doubt you've brought that much. Upgrading this one, we can get as far as armed merchant vessel, which everyone will assume means pirate, but that's about it. She'd need a new in-system drive, some decent shielding, and at least two decent weapons systems. It'd cut our cargo capacity 30%, and it isn't that big already.
You've already thought about it.
Of course. I haven't been twiddling my thumbs. I've thought of several things. Running her as a cargo ship under Vatta colors, likely to get us attacked and blown up entirely too soon. Running her as a cargo ship under other colors, my own for one, and hoping nobody figures out she's really Vatta. That would require a new ship chip of clandestine origin and time to build up a clientele. The kinds of cargoes you can get in an uninsured, unknown ship are, as you know, minimal. Running her as an armed merchanter, trying to combine light cargo, probably clandestine, with covert attacks on the guilty parties if we ever figure out who they are. That is dangerous and unlikely to make the kind of profits that will keep us going, unless we take on seriously bad cargo.
Seriously bad cargo may lead us to our enemies.
Yes, it could. Either usefully or right into their trap. You surely know that Vatta corporate accounts are frozen, credit unobtainable right along with insurance for either ship or cargo.
I didn't realize accounts would all be frozen. I was able to access funds on all Ray.
They're frozen here, and other places I've heard of. I've sold off the cargo we came in with, and I have a few goodies that Aunt Gracie stuffed into a fruitcake for me, but not enough to buy a new ship or convert this one to armed merchanter.
I'll add mine to the pile and see what it comes to.
What interests me is that you and Rafe seem to have been doing the same thing for different employers. You really didn't know he was ISC?
No. I can't believe he never told me. And where he came up with that sob story from...
Doesn't matter. How reliable do you think he is, really? How much of that attitude is surface?
I would trust him to be who he is, but I'm not sure any longer who that is. Stick to the terms of a partnership, yes. Actually care about anyone? I'm not sure.
We've got a tough task ahead, Stella. We can use all the allies we can find, but we need them to be allies. Or at least acting from enlightened self-interest.
He's smart. I would say his self-interest is paramount, but intelligently adapted to circumstances. Reliable within limits. Within those limits? Absolutely.
What do you know about his expertise?
What you'd expect from someone involved in corporate espionage. There's not a lock, physical or electronic, that he can't open. Few, if any, databases that are secure if you turn him loose for an hour. And he has a remarkable collection of contacts in multiple systems. If he's telling the truth about being Dunbarger's son, then I suspect his actual illicit earnings are much lower than he's claimed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.